Hello and welcome to this special edition of Our Faith, Our Diocese. I'm Dan Gallagher. After more than two decades of dreaming and planning, the finishing touches are being put on the new worship space here at Most Holy Trinity Parish in Cresco. Over the last several months, Sordoni Construction has been renovating what was the gymnasium auditorium for the former Monsignor McHugh Elementary School into the beautiful church you see here today. What makes this project unique, though, is that in addition to the work that Sordoni has been doing, a number of parish volunteers have been donating their time and talents to complete everything else that was needed for this project.
It really is quite a story, and that this kind of centrally located. I asked somebody, I said, is it geographically in between the three? And they said, not really, but it's close enough to the three parish communities where this was central, and the diocese and their generosity provided the opportunity. So, and here in the Poconos, real estate is a little bit pricey, so to be able to have property to work with and to add another school onto a campus that already had a Catholic grade school and a convent at which was used in the past isn't currently being used or hasn't been for a little bit, but to have all that and to be able then to incorporate things into one location, more central, and it's not that one parish or another kind of one out that it's at one place and we're just expanding, everybody else comes from the other two parishes to the third parish. No, it's a central new location, new beginning for three communities coming together as one.
Now, when you think back about what this room was originally, and this served as the gymnasium auditorium for Monsignor McHugh Elementary, do you think most people, when they come in here for the first time, are they going to be overwhelmed by the transformation from what was to what it is today?
For me, coming in late in the game here, that I asked, all right, so what did it look like when it was a gymnasium? And they said, oh, where you're standing now, right over here in the choir loft, that would be where the scoreboard was, and I think I had this right, and where the sanctuary is, that was a stage. So when the school was having plays and we were here as a parish community, we'd set up the chairs, have to disassemble so they could do their plays, and then for basketball, the hoops would be lowered from the ceiling, and then on the weekend, and there were points where the school had activities on the weekend, and Mass on the grass. They had a big tent outside. So they went from having Mass in the gym, then it was relocated outside, then it was kind of in that hallway space, which is now our overflow. Now it's currently in the what was the cafeteria being moved into the gymnasium. But when you come in here now, overwhelming is the word, because you just can't imagine that this was a gymnasium at one time. And then when I was coming out here and the bishop mentioned, he said, there is no church there per se right now, but it's being completed. It was the gym, it will be a church. And I said, all right, whatever it is, it may still look like a gym when I get there. I hadn't seen it until I arrived for the new assignment. And then when I got here, I thought, sometimes you see a church that looks like a gym because that's what it was originally. But I thought, this was probably a gym that looked like a church, because it really is in the form of a church. It looks like it was made for this. It really is a perfect setup. So it's wonderful, the transformation and the job and the imagination and ingenuity that all involved had to have it all come together. Really, it's impressive. You have to be here to see it in person. They did a wonderful job of preserving everything at that time and saying that we want to incorporate items from the three churches, in fact, as much as possible, and they really have. They may have used all the stained glass windows, but also incorporated the retreat house, the Villa of Our Lady. And so we have a stained glass window from there and other items from the retreat house. So we have that plus the three parishes, and also in addition, some of the mission churches that were all part of that. So many people along the way did a wonderful job preserving what was needed, and then those in the present church incorporating all of that in such a dignified way to bring it all together. I've had people say when they walked in they couldn't believe it, because the church from their parish, they said, actually that was a stained glass window, it was on the side of the church that didn't get a lot of sunlight, so we never got a great look at it the way we're seeing it now with the lighting that we have for all the stained glass windows. And it is, and I've heard that before by other people saying when parishes merge together, when they bring in those pieces, they were hoping they'd feel better about having to go to a new location. But once they did and they saw that and experienced it, they felt a sense of welcome, peace, and belonging. So I expect that they will fully feel that. Even with the Sordoni group, and then we have a few subcontractors and some who are parishioners, they've just gone so far above and beyond anything that just a normal bringing in of a subcontractor or a contractor would do. It's been wonderful. That's what's made the difference in the volunteers. It's 5 days a week minimum, probably 8 hours a day. They're just here all the time, no matter what the problem is, the issue is. They're right there on the spot. You just call them or you reach out to them, and they're here for all the masses on the weekend, and they're always around. So if there's an issue they're always checking the bathrooms, the fire alarms, whatever it is, they're here on the weekend. They come for mass and they do like a spot check while they're here because they can't help it. They just want, and they're here all week long. So even on the weekend, they can't help but go in and make sure everything's running smoothly. When this whole plan was developing, they thought, well, it's a nice plan. We just don't know if it will ever come to fruition. And they said, once that started to become a reality, we were just so excited that everybody just jumped on board, and they started asking others they knew from their prior parish and said, if you can help, this is what we're doing. And there's such a crew of volunteers, of assistants, and I mean, even the Women's Guild, and you name it, they're doing everything. The people who do the decorating, the music, the cleaning, the everything, start to finish. I mean, and the attention to making sure our CCD students are well-educated and taken care of through this transition, because even for them, they were in temporary space for a long time, but they didn't miss a beat on any of that. So again, I think this is the highlight, the culmination of everything they were hoping for, and I think that really generated a lot of enthusiasm throughout the years. On the bulletin board, before you enter, we have photos of what the church looked like when it was transitioning from a gymnasium. And that's what it looked like when I got here in January, which wasn't all that long ago. It was still steel girders in the ceiling and cinder block walls. I was seeing plasterboard starting to go up, and that was literally just months ago. And all of a sudden, every day, there was something new changing and transforming. And when they come in, even if you look at a photo or images online, which are all very helpful, and they kind of whet the appetite, but until you get here, you just can't imagine the breadth of the whole thing and the scope. It's so big. But it all comes together, so like the sense of a cathedral, that type. It really is. It's something that is a wonderful completion to a long journey. Well, that's what's made it the blessing, the support from day one. And I thought, all right, whatever kind of transition, they'll have to get used to a new priest and just to be patient with all that. I haven't needed to do any of that because they were so welcoming from day one, right across the board, without exception. And part of it has to do with enthusiasm of this project and how well it's been going and how now it's ready to be completed. What some thought would never happen is now coming through in such a great way, I think even grander than anybody could have envisioned.
Originally, as we spoke, the whole back section of the school was going to be done by outside contractors. And we had the initial estimates, and the pricing looked like it was something that we could handle. And as time went on, material costs went up, the project designs changed, and as the prices kept going up and up, we realized that, you know, we wouldn't be able to basically afford it. So we started taking portions of it that, you know, we thought that we had the skill set to handle, and started taking that off the plate from, like, the architect at that point. When it came to this area right here, it's too big. We don't have the manpower, the materials, the resources to do something like this size in a timely manner. So we kind of drew the line where we could demarcate between where we needed help and what we could do on our own, and we decided to take it over on our own. So, like I said, we had plumbers, we had electricians, tile people, carpenters, and, you know, whoever could volunteer. Just in the early days, it was a matter of everyone being here. It was the demolition portion, so everybody was, you know, knocking things down. And then, you know, as it got down to the skills, it went off to whoever had the particular skill sets that started working on stuff. And we still have, you know, general people cleaning and doing stuff like that, but the core people that, you know, the tile people and stuff like that, you know, knocked a big chunk off the price of the building. I think it comes to the point that all of us have been going to church since we were young, and you just went to church. The church was there. Whoever was ahead of you had done all the legwork as far as building it and getting it established, and you went and just attended. This was the point in time when, you know, we needed a church. So it was, if we don't do it, it won't get done. So you jumped in and you did your part. So this is a look back, or my grandkids could look back and I'll say that this is something that Grandpa did. This is what I could do, and I think everyone else that's working here is kind of that same mindset. This is what we could do, and we're doing our part. My son had gone to school here, and I still remember the days when he was up on stage playing guitar, or, you know, just going to school here. And for me, knowing what it was and seeing where it's gone, I mean, is phenomenal. Yourself coming in and never seeing it, if you were blindfolded and came in here and just looked, you would think this was a brand new church, you know, built just as a church. Knowing the history of it now, I mean, makes it that much more, you know, of an endeavor to take a gymnasium and make it into a church. I think it's phenomenal. It's beautiful. You know, it matches any other church that I've been in. In the initial point in time, as the buildings were closing, we were pulling out the stained glass with the mindset that whenever we did go and start building another church, that we'd be incorporating things in. At the point when we started consolidating with the other two churches, the same thought had gone in. So the items like the pews, the stained glass, the statues, vestments, anything that was part of that church that we foresaw would be possibly used in the new church, we had started storing. I think that binds everything together. So if you're coming from your church, it's not your church, this is a new church, but you can look around and still see items, you know, these were the pews that you sat in, or these were the windows that you had, you know, seen in your church. So it, while there's three different congregations coming together into one building now, they're still part of each of them in this building, so it helps bind everybody together. I am very proud. It's, like I said, I could feel that it's a part of me now, you know, the fact that you've helped build it, and I'm sure everyone else that's worked on it gets that same. It's almost like the feeling you get at your house. You know, you're proud of it, it's yours, and the fact that you were the one that built your own house or you did your own work makes it even that much more proud. It's part of you.
Basically, Sardoni was responsible for pretty much everything inside the main church, and anything outside of the main church was the responsibility of the parish volunteer that was outside their scope of work. All of the spaces were gutted and rebuilt. The bleacher board that we talked about, there was miles of bleacher board from inside here. They plugged it, planed it, sanded it, polyurethane it, and it's used for all of the trim, all the wainscoting. There's a giant cross in the narthex. And it ties all the way through the building. The idea was to tie everything together all the way through the building and to tie back to the school, you know, the school itself. There's several elements from the school that tie in. Out in the concourse, they took all of the bronze dedication plates. They're all hanging in one place, so under a spotlight, so they're there. And the crucifix, which hangs over the altar, is the crucifix that hung in the gym here for 60 years. It's the same crucifix that was in here the entire time that the school was open. From the very beginning, they wanted to use elements from all of the churches to bring into the space. There are items, the bishop, when he was getting behind us, donated when they renovated the cathedral, the altar, the ambo, the baptistry, they're all from the cathedral. Elements from St. Anne's, there's windows and pews, St. Mary's, the Stations of the Cross and the pews, St. Bernadette's, the priest chairs, some of the stained glass out in the other areas, from St. Mary's. St. Joan of Arc, we have a statue which is not up yet, but it's there. And even Our Lady of Fatima, which was up in Promised Land, the holy water dippers, and the school itself, the crucifix, and the villa house over that was used to be across from Mount Airy, the Villa of Our Lady. There's a number of elements, including the parts of the pews and things in the day chapel that we built. We had built a day chapel out of one of the classrooms. That's some of the elements that you were talking about that the volunteers doing. because the original chapel here is upstairs. And so with an elderly population, you wanted the day chapel to be on, he wanted day chapel on the first floor. So we built a day chapel, which I don't know if you got a chance to see, but that was built, renovating the offices, the pastor's office, conference rooms. Mark and Tom turned a custodial closet into a beautiful bathroom. It was just everybody's thrown together and really just done, you know, everybody took their little particular skills and applied them. They took all the elements from the church and the three main parishes that came together to form Most Holy Trinity. And the idea was that all of the churches had statuary and marble and wood and stained glass, but none of the churches had any mosaic. So the mosaics that are throughout the building, two here in the church and then some out near the rest of the building, were commissioned to be just Most Holy Trinity, to unify the church and say, this is Most Holy Trinity. And so we were all together, even though there's little bits and pieces of everything everywhere, they were a unifying factor. It's a labor of love. We've been waiting a long time for this church to be built. Going back, those who came down from St. Mary's before the merger, we had started a new church up there 25 years ago. So this is actually 25 years in the making for those folks that came down from St. Mary's. And it was just the guys are doing, you do what you have to do. And the idea is to, you're working for God, and you're working for, so the congregation has a beautiful place to worship. That's the whole, everybody just kind of threw in and took their skills and did what they're supposed to do to make sure that everybody had a good worship experience. You know, everybody can get together and worship God and be pleasant and have a pleasant place to do it in. It's just fantastic. I mean, it's shocking. If you were somebody who was here when saw it as a gym, well, we worshiped in the gym for almost 10 years. So, and, you know, folding chairs, and you have to break it down at the end of the day on Sunday so that school could be back in here. And just, it's stunning. When we've had, you know, a parishioner every once in a while will come by and you get to show them a little bit. It's either goosebumps or tears or both. You know, people are crying, or they see something that was from one of the other churches and they get all emotional and well up. But we've been waiting so long for this that I haven't seen anybody come in and not be completely overwrought with emotion. You know, it's just a very emotional thing. We've worshipped, we're a very resilient group. We've worshipped literally everywhere. We had our parishes, and even when we combined the parishes initially, the churches stayed open, then they closed. Then we're here in the gym. Then partly during COVID, we were out on the lawn. And then before there was a floor in the narthex, we were down in the concourse. It was kind of jammed down. It was a little tight down there. And then when the narthex opened up, we moved over there. And now we're ready to move in here. So we've pretty much worshipped everywhere we could find a spot. It is a very proud moment. And again, I said going back 25 years to St. Mary's, it's a proud moment that we finally have this beautiful church for our congregation to meet and worship in, and it's been a long time coming. And you know, our individual churches were all lovely, and everything was good, but we've, like I said, very resilient. We've been through a lot of iterations in between, and now it is a gorgeous space, and everybody who's done work should be very proud of their work. I don't think you'll get them to say that, you know, they're not going to come out and say they're proud of their work, but they all should be, because the group that works in here really has done a terrific job. And Sordoni did brilliant work. They were very. Their craftsmen did really, really excellent work on the building itself. Everything was really well done.
This is like a totally different place. It's not the same place as far as looking at it. I mean, this is not a gym. This is a church. And before, it was a gym. But it's like two different things. It's like you don't see the in between. So you really see it as the finished product now, more than before. We did bring the churches that you did close, and that was important because a lot of people many were attached to the old churches. And now when they come and they see part of their church here, they'll find that, you know, it wasn't lost. It was actually, you know, made use of. You know, before it was all like they thought they'd never see their church again. And now they can come in and they can see their church, because they could see part of St. Mary's, they could see part of St. Anne's, and they could see part of St. Bernadette. Well, at the beginning, I think they're going to go, it's going to be an awe. I mean, a real, like, wow. You know, they're not going to, it's unbelievable. Because most people have not really seen the finished product yet. Only a few have. So I think for most people, it's going to be like and awe, and they're gonna say, well, it was worth it.
We did not ever give up, and we do not believe that our labor was in vain. We humbly offer you the keys to our parish and beseech you to provide us with your blessing.
Thank you. Thank you. Bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For all that takes our breath away, really, when we come in here, and perhaps for you, it's, some of you at least, this is the first time that you've really experienced this glorious space. It's kind of a miracle to think that there was a basketball hoop here and over there and in the back and a stage behind me. And now we gather, not in a makeshift space, but in a beautiful, elegant tribute to the power and the presence of God. Look at what you've done, not just in constructing this incredible worship space, but look more importantly at what you've done for one another. You have celebrated life, and you've called one another to respect and reverence that most incredible gift of God. You've shared your faith with young children and old. You've fed families, and you've taken care of the poor in your midst. You've welcomed new members. You've healed bodies and spirits. You've consoled, you've buried, and you've converted hearts to the Lord. You've served so well the lives that God has woven into your own. In all of those things that I've just described and more, far more than the effort that you put into building this beautiful space for worship, you have first done Christ's work. You have done Christ's work in building and sustaining a community of believers. And that, more than anything else, becomes the rock-solid foundation upon which this house of worship has been built.
It's beautiful. It's just, it's stunning. It's amazing to see how far it has come and how much work has been done. And it really just, it's breathtaking. It's beautiful. I had been a parishioner lifelong at St. Mary of the Mount. And I definitely did recognize the Stations of the Cross were from St. Mary's, and I think some of the pews are, and there's a lot. And I had spent some time at St. Anne's as well, so I recognize the windows. It's beautiful to see those things come together and kind of remind everybody of our roots and where we came from, and now we come together here. It's nice.
Well, I'm amazed by all the windows. I've known all three churches, and I can see how everything's been put to use. But most of all, I'm just happy to see that we have a beautiful dwelling place to come to worship every day, especially on Sundays and the high holy days. If I can quote a little scripture, this is the day the Lord has made, and we are rejoicing, and we are truly glad.
This was our gym. We played basketball here against, you know, Scranton teams and the Pocono Mountain teams. And, you know, we did everything in here. We graduated from this space. And now look at it. This is our new church. And it's unbelievable. And I can't thank everybody enough, the bishop and the people in the diocese that worked hard to put it together, and all the local people. It's glorious. I don't know what else to say.
Final word, really, as I look out over this community here, as I reflect upon not just these last few hours, but these many years, and as I see these pews filled, for the naysayers in our world who say that faith doesn't matter anymore, for all those who say we Catholics, we Christians, are just grasping at straws, let them come to Cresco. And let them look at this community of faith. What a blessing. Thank you.
God in love is standing.